Filmmaker John Waters became famous for groundbreaking cult films that have provoked and even shocked audiences, stretching the boundaries of good taste to what some consider the breaking point. This weekend, a major retrospective of his visual artwork opens in his hometown at the Baltimore Museum of Art. NewsHour Weekend's Christopher Booker recently sat down with Waters to discuss film, photography, and the art of making people uncomfortable.
There was a time when it wasn't safe to like John Waters. Once dubbed the Pope of Trash, the writer and director spent years pushing the boundaries of cinematic decency.
You're sick and repulsive!
You, my dear, are dead!
His incendiary films from the 60s and 70s, satirizing violence, celebrity, and sexuality, shocked audiences around the world. Films like Multiple Maniacs, Female Trouble, and Pink Flamingos, his 1972 underground classic starring drag queen Divine, were censored and banned in some countries. But audiences couldn't get enough.
I try to eavesdrop and spy on people. That's my job, is to go out and report to the unwashed public, my fans, the unfathomable behavior of Americans.
By the end of the 1980s, the world of John Waters had started to attract a more mainstream audience, driven in large part by the 1988 release of PG-rated Hairspray. But even though his work has expanded beyond the underground, Waters never stopped trying to antagonize our tastes, and not just in the movies. He has challenged America's palette of decency in books, on Broadway, even on the walls of the contemporary art world.
Oh, good, they're gonna put one up here, let's see. So this is a self-portrait.
And now for the first time, some of this work has been collected for a major retrospective for the Baltimore Museum of Art. It's appropriately titled Indecent Exposure.
A lot of these pieces you haven't seen in years.
No, because they've been in collectors' homes. You know, you have to go to all the collectors and find them and get them back. So I know, it's amazing to walk through it. I haven't seen any of them really till after I had the show.
With over 160 photographs, sculptures, soundworks, and videos, Indecent Exposure includes all the idiosyncratic subversiveness synonymous with John Waters.
Eat these gosh darn chickens!
There's Children Who Smoke, a montage of some of Hollywood's most beloved child stars as cigarette smokers. Or Sneaky JFK, a replica doll of America's 35th president wearing one of Jacqueline Kennedy's gowns. Or Beverly Hills John, a reimagined self-portrait of Waters, had he elected to have plastic surgery.
I think people are going to say, oh, he got work. They're just going to think I look like that now. I believe that there will be pet facelifts if there isn't already. They would have made Lassie get one. I was never frightened to try new stuff because that's what people expect if they come to see my show. They want to be taken sometimes into a world that they might feel uncomfortable with, and I'm their guide, though. Because I don't think I'm mean. I might ask you to consider something, but I don't think if I'm trying to shock, I'm trying to make you laugh at the same time. Because I'm still amazed by things that I don't understand. That's what always interests me, that there is no clear answer to it. It's easy to shock people. It's much harder to make them laugh. So when I was in Catholic school, I was obsessed by writing 7734 over. So you can have this on your wall, and then it depends what your day's like. It's like a mood ring. You can turn it upside down to hell.
The retrospective moves between the mischievous and macabre, some of the work offering reimaginings of some of our culture's shared tragedies.
This was such an innocent childhood memory, this movie that I loved as a kid where flying saucers attack Washington. But now, when you put it with 9/11, it makes it very, very terrible that it could happen today in a completely different way.
But a constant throughout the exhibit is Waters' continued appetite to prod and provoke our love of film, television, and celebrity. Mass media is his medium.
And that's Elizabeth Taylor getting a facelift where her mustache basically turns into my mustache. So I'm just writing with different images from different films to tell a completely new story that wasn't there.
Do you find a greater supply of motivational fuel, given the expansion of media and unbelievable explosion of pop culture and celebrity culture?
The media to me is my soap opera. Every day I watch it. And I still get 6 newspapers delivered every day. I still consume the news a lot, which I think if you write comedy in any way, you have to be on top of what the news is. It's fun to me. I like writing. I like telling stories. And even in the photographs and the artwork I do, and I even hate to call it artwork because that's up to others to say, not to me. I always say when people say, I'm an artist. Oh, really? I believe history will be the judge of that. But at the same time, you know, I'm going to say I'm a photographer, then it sounds like I'm Ansel Adams, you know. Yeah. I have a piece called Cancel Ansel, which is actually where I screw up his photography by putting in his beautiful scenery like cruise ships and, you know, litter and naked people swimming and that kind of thing.
there's an intimidation, especially as it relates to the contemporary art world. If you're not in the club, it's frightening to try to get in.
I like that about it, that it's a secret biker club that hates you. I even have a piece that says contemporary art hates you, because it does if you hate it first. It's a thin line. You can't have contempt about it and go in, but you have to learn. You have to study a little. You have to figure it out why these things happen. And then suddenly this whole world opens up to you. You can see in a completely different way. It's like you were blind before.
Do you think it would be hard to set out on your course as a young person now?
It might be easier because every Hollywood studio is looking for the next kid that made a movie with a cell phone. They weren't when I was. It's still tough. It's always going to be tough. And if you have to ask, how can I do it, you'll never do it. The whole thing is to figure out how to do it, how to get in there and figure out how to do it. And this one is to inspire order. Every day of my life, I have a file card that I write down what I have to do and cross it off. So get busy.
The thing is, they're all crossed off. So you did them.
I did them all, yeah. and so this is called, 300 days, whatever it's called. It's 300 days.
Were you orderly as a kid? I mean, it must have been something.
No, I took LSD every day. No, I wasn't orderly. If you want to be an artist, go to all the art shows, read the art magazines. Figure out which gallery would be the best one for you that shows work you like that maybe might do it. You have to learn how the whole thing works and have an interest in it, which I always did. And this is another tabloid one, if there was a tabloid for intellectuals, basically.
Yeah.
It's certainly an intellectual secret life. I never understand when people say you're bored. Just walk outside and watch people. Sit in an airport. I make up a story about every single person I see getting off the plane. Instant bio. In 1 second,
What do you think will last longer, your visual work or your films?
I don't know, you just hope any of it does, you know? Well, you think that way, sure you do, and that's why you keep working in a way. I think it would be all remembered as one thing that I've done, because my books and my spoken word shows, and it's all telling stories. Generally, when I die, Pink Flamingos will be in the first paragraph of my obituary and Hairspray. Before this, probably. If they write it, who knows? You can go out of fashion really quickly, and people, forget. It depends how much longer. We ain't gonna live that long, really, to live down the trouble I've left.